Thanks, Mike. Yes, good morning.
Morning.
The reason we got into conversation before we should, really, because you were reminiscing a little bit about Glastonbury and performing at Glastonbury.
Yeah.
And there was a lot of interest. Tell us a little bit about the tale.
Oh, my God.
Oh, my God. It was they had to close the stage off.
The whole area had to close the field.
And it was crazy because we were told before we went on, there's a few more people than expected, because we expected like 3,000. And then it was like, okay, so security has been called.
Police locked off the corners.
Yeah.
Yeah. And they were saying, you know, if anyone makes this sign when you're on stage, you know, you have to stop the
show. What was the sign?
I think it's that, right?
Yeah. Oh, but in case it's getting a bit too...
Do it again, because no one's...
Oh, sorry. Yeah. I think it's that. I mean, there was a lot going on before the show, and we've never had that before, and had, you know, so...
Yeah, it was amazing.
It feels good, though, doesn't it?
Yeah, it was such a celebration. They really got into it, and it was...
Well, I suppose
amazing.
If you insist on coming back and getting together again after a while... Yeah. That's what happens.
People
get interested.
I guess so.
Yeah, it's a little bit more now, though, than 9 years ago, because we first reformed, like... 9 years ago under the name MKS, and then we won the Sugar Babes Neighbour. We had a few shows, but this is like, I don't know.
You
what's
might
happening.
Need to explain a little bit more of that in a moment the name going away and then coming back, but we'll come back to that in a minute. Shall we look back at some of the songs?
Yeah, why not?
Absolutely should have done. We should have kept your mics up while we were going through those videos. The commentary was fantastic. So, Siobhan, there's a top in there you still have.
That's from Overload.
From Overload. But you said it doesn't fit anymore.
Probably not. I haven't tried it.
When you do Revival, the outfits are part of it as well. So you never know. You should bring this back. And then, Mutu, you were talking about the funky tape. Hairstyle that actually hurt. There.
Yeah, round. I had like gaffer tape and rope all in my hair, so it was quite a lot going on. But I definitely wouldn't do that again.
And Keisha, we'll talk about control as well, about like how much of your body image and images you might have had. And Keisha, you were saying that there was an eye infection.
Yeah, so I had contacting for the video Too Lost in You, and one of them became infected, and so my eye blew up, and so I had to like swipe my hair across one side of my face just to
rock and roll,
get through.
The things you have to do.
Yeah.
Now, so go back to the conversation we were having before. So the people who don't know, so you were performing again, the three of you together, but you weren't able to perform under the name Sugar Babes.
No.
So you can just give us the quick explanation of how that was and now how you can.
Well, it was definitely a legal fight, pretty much, but we feel like we're the underdogs. We stuck together and through the 9 years, and just, you know, that's who we are. We came up with a name when we were, you know, kids.
11,
we were like 11 and 12 years old, and we just felt like it's actually ours, so we just stuck together and, yeah.
And so it came to be, and now you're able to perform in that name again.
Yeah.
I alluded to it. You were talking about your hair, the hairstyle, and actually being painful. When people say you suffered for your art, now you're back together. You have been for 9 years, but now you are older than you were when you first entered the industry. How much more in control do you feel? And when you look back, what kind of would you have said to yourselves back then?
Oh, my God. I think, for me personally, I think I would have just most probably enjoyed it and embraced things a lot more and appreciated it. The Second Chance van is amazing, because we get to do it all over again, but be more, you know, open-minded about everything. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, and it's a bit more relaxed and we're having fun right now, so it's good.
Yeah, for sure. I think we always were one of the lucky groups that were able to have a form of control, just as far as like our first still that we had was very much like in our favour.
What do you mean still? The pictures?
Well, I think with bands in general,
oh,
they
deal,
don't
pop
bands, sorry, yeah. record deal. And just we've always written our own stuff. We've always.
That's really
But
important.
I think just, yeah, but I think as we've gotten older, we've realised that it's the music business and that's the difference. So, yeah.
You don't take it so personally.
No.
Yeah.
Oh, that's, well, good, that's a good place to be.
And that's different now compared to when you first started in terms of social media.
Oh, yes. I'm glad we missed that era as kids, because that would have just been a...
There literally was no social media back then.
Thank God. You wouldn't have been able to go to the under-18 raves, would we?
No.
Absolutely not.
Now, you tell me, this period of time, the early 2000s, aren't there? There were quite a lot of girl bands and boy bands around the time. Was there a time when this girl band, the Sugar Babes, sort of met a boy band for the first time, and a kind of like a moment at, I don't know, what are they, Top of the Pops or one of those places where you hadn't met and then there was a kind of, did you sort of meet
with
much?
Other boy bands?
Oh, there was loads.
We probably had, there was shows like Top of the Pops and stuff back then, so you met.
Now look, something is going on.
She's like,
something is going on here.
We have tons of stories, but it was always really great, like when we did like things like smash hits or even
amazing,
because you're so isolated. Many people don't know that when you're like travelling so often, it's just the three of you and then the, you know, your glam squad and tour managers. So when we got to see other, you know,
people,
artists and stuff, we had fun.
Who's
Puff Daddy has thrown, he threw an amazing party years ago
MTV
Europe Awards.
And then we're also good friends with a lot of the UK bands as well, like the Blues, the Blazing Squads. There was loads.
Loads. Yeah, we had a good time.
Basically all the English, like...
There's a kind of assumption. I think people make an assumption that you all know, maybe you do now, all know each other, but there's an assumption that you all know each other, you're all meeting each other all the time, and that clearly that's not the case because you're busy and you're working.
Oh, yeah, I think just life, I think just with anything, it's almost like when you're with everyone like all the time and then you have to split yourself so much. I mean, as you get older, even more so now, because then you become a mum and all these things, but back then you're like splitting yourself between you've got
school,
then you've got school, and then you've got your friends, and then you've got your family. And if your family's big like mine, you've got, you know, the Buchanans and the Browns, and it's just like, how do you fit everyone in? So I think it was a balancing act, and it still is.
What have the conversations changed then? Now, you mentioned family, you mentioned being a mum. I mean, when you're talking, and you're still creating music, I'm assuming, but that is in between the runs, the school runs, the nappy changes, the nursery runs, you know, whatever. How are those conversations now?
Well, it's tricky this summer because we've just been sort of back-to-back rehearsals, summer
festivals,
shows, you know, now the promo for the tour and the creative for the tour. So actually we haven't been able to get into the studio this summer.
Yeah.
So we are just kind of slammed. But, but you know, it is really important to live your personal life as well, you know, and as you said, we've got our families now, and we make sure that we make that work for each other.
I know, I'm sorry, I don't know how old various children are.
But I've got a 2-year-old and a 4-year-old.
Okay.
Matthias.
I've got 17-year-olds.
Ah.
Yeah. I mean, you should see them together. It's amazing. I haven't got kids yet.
Okay.
We'll be seeing them soon, hopefully.
Can I ask about your... And you tell me whatever you wish, your 17-year-old. Children can be quite blunt sometimes, can't they?
Oh, yeah,
they'll speak
is.
Their mind. And they... I don't know, when the first time she was aware of, you know, what you did and what you do. And have you ever had any funny conversations along those lines?
To be honest, actually, 1 o'clock this morning, she messaged me saying, with a video saying... all I was trying to do was watch TV and you keep popping up on it. And it was an advert on YouTube of our tour. And she sent me the video and she was like, I'm just trying to watch TV and you just keep coming up on my screen.
Is she proud or embarrassed?
Very proud. Oh, very, very proud. She comes to all of our shows.
But she's just not, she's not like, oh my God, my mum's a sugar babe. She's just like, yeah, it's my auntie Siobhan, my aunt Keisha.
Yeah, she calls us auntie and I just
love
that. And
it's just, honestly, she's good.
She's proud of all of us.
And yours are a lot younger, obviously.
Yes. Mm-hmm. So they're still...
Did they just think mummy just jumps up and down and dances a lot?
Yeah, I think my son, who's 4 and a half, just about understands maybe this time around. Like, because I tried to get him to watch us on Graham Norton, but he was 2 and a half, so... Yeah. That didn't
work. That's a bit much.
As entertaining as Graham is,
I want him to come and see us at one of our shows later in the summer.
That'd be nice.
And then I think the penny might drop.
And so you're doing quite a bit of live stuff?
A lot. Yeah, we've got a tour. The tickets are out now, and
they go on sale in like an hour, I think.
Mm-hmm. I do. Okay. Wow.
Everyone.
Amazing. And then, it's in October.
And we're with Westlife this week.
And just going back to Glastonbury thing, did you get a chance to see anyone else? I mean, I don't know. Sometimes you're kind of in and out.
Oh, you did?
Yeah.
She stayed on and partied on.
Okay.
Yeah, I did. Well, I went, my niece was there, who's 14. It was her first time at Glastonbury, and I just wanted to show her around a bit.
I don't know if you saw the interview you did a moment ago with a young artist who's just got the gig with Adele, you know, who's a supporting artist. Can you remember a moment, you know, one of those moments when I don't know, what was the first record contract, the first time someone went, yep, this is going to work, you know,
there was someone huge and you were just like, this is a new world.
I mean, there's been so many moments like that. I mean, for one, I think just even when we first came together as a group, Ron, who was our first manager, he was like, OK, once there was two of you, now there's three of you. And he had actually formed the All Saints and came up with their name. He named them after the road that he lived on. That was something that is, you know, and he was, like, all around Mark Morrison at the time. So that, like, for me...
Misha Paris.
At the time, it was like, oh, my God, this is big. But also just, like, little things like meeting Victoria Beckham at our first Top of the Pops and being a huge Spice Girls fan was amazing.
Oh, Missy Elliott at MTV in Germany.
Being a huge fan. The ground shaking from all the name dropping. Mucha, Keisha, Siobhan, good luck.
Thank you so much. Come and see us on tour.
Yes, and all of you.
As they said, tickets go on sale today. You are watching Breakfast. It is 8:59.